the message that kind of formed in the sense of the album was that the only moment that you have is the present moment, and that all you can do is live it to the fullest and take advantage of the opportunities that you have in that present moment, because you may never get this moment again. The initial inspiration for the album started with this book that I was reading called Love Saves the Day. It's basically just tells the story of kind of 70s New York and the birth of disco music. There were things that resonated with me and I think found its way into the music. And I think largely those things were escapism and euphoria. Rather than focusing on like exactly how the disco was made or how it sounded, it was more about how it made me feel. I became kind of fascinated with the intensity of those emotions, and they're tied to the dance floor. I think that I'd never really thought about the dance floor when making music. I'd never focused on how that would feel. That sort of ended up becoming a huge part of the inspiration on this album, I think. It was actually my manager, Grant, who turned to me and he was just like, well, the album was called Good Times. And what kind of seemed like a heavy-handed disco reference at the time was actually just like a very simple and direct summary of what the album was about. 2020 comes around and for the first time, parties didn't exist anymore and there was no return in sight. That's why the album ended up becoming Times instead of Good Times, because I couldn't really call an album Good Times in 2020 because it's been a pretty shit time, to be honest. Collaboration is a huge part of what I do, and it's a huge part of the album. It was important for me to work with those people that created so much of the music that I had become inspired by. So for instance, Nile Rodgers, you know, Robin, who is, for me, kind of just defined this dance floor tearjerker music. Aside from the features, there's also people that I work with and songwriters. So, you know, Julian Vanetta was a huge part of this album. Orlando Higginbottom, also known as Totally Enormous Extinct Dinosaurs, who is one of my hero producers. And then Sophie Francis Cook, who is basically, you know, my musical sister at this point. We've been writing songs together since the day we left uni, pretty much. I moved to Liverpool when I was 18 years old to go study sound engineering at Liverpool Institute of Performing Arts. It was a really formative couple of years for me. I remember one of the first nights out I ever had was at Chibuku, and it was just this kind of thundering kick drums. It just felt like something that had been missing my whole life. I don't know. I just at that moment kind of knew. I was like, okay, this is going to be important. It's cool now to be coming back to the dance floor on this album because it's really where it started, so it kind of felt full circle. We kind of went around and explored some of those clubs which are currently closed. It was bittersweet because, you know, I had so many memories in those clubs, and you're also reminded of an industry that is on its knees right now and an industry that is completely broken by what's going on.
Wow. So weird. Blimey. It looks so different when it's empty. Yeah, so we're in Phonox in Brixton, which is a club that I spent a lot of time in. I used to live around the corner. It's pretty weird being back in here right now, you know, at a time where anyone's been in a club for about 7 months now. I don't know, when you see it in this state, it's pretty sad, pretty sorry. Yeah, it's just very, very odd seeing it as empty. It's just something I really miss. I think life is pretty fucking boring without it. I think that without moments to look back at and without, you know, experiences and things that make life worth living, then it's all pretty dull. And I think that it's a shame that we kind of are in a situation right now where we have a government that just doesn't really care.
It makes me worry for the future of clubbing because those experiences were so formative for me. And I think that for anyone who makes electronic music, they need those experiences to, you know, set them on a path of inspiration that then leads to them creating music and DJing. But right now there's a whole generation who aren't having those experiences and aren't falling in love with that. So I fear for the future of clubbing and of electronic music for that reason, because so much of it is centered around what happens in those rooms and the connections that people make. And when I'm old, or when I'm, you know, on my deathbed, I think I'll look back and some of those moments are going to be like the most significant moments in my life. And it's not because they were hedonistic or, you know, it's just like it's some of the most joyful moments I can think of in my life.